So welcome to everyone who's joining us. We're going to give it just a couple of minutes as folks are logging in, and then we'll get started here. Okay, welcome everyone. So we are excited to have you here with us for day two of the Social Workers Confronting Racial Injustice Conference. We are excited to welcome new participants, as well as those of you who are back for day two with us and who were able to attend last week. If you missed it, most of the presentations were recorded and will be available on our conference website. So we hope you'll check them out. I'm Tova Walsh, and I'm happy you're here for this breakout presentation on understanding the impact of racism and white supremacy on the US immigration system in order to better serve people that are undocumented and documented by our two esteemed presenters, Erin Barbato and Erika Rosales. We'd also like to encourage you to stick around after this presentation for our closing panel, which will feature Dr. Demita Brown, Jacqueline Bogis, and Sakara Wages. We'll put a link to the panel in the chat at the end of the presentation so that you can easily find your way. Before we get started today, it's important to take a moment to honor Indigenous people by sharing our university's land acknowledgement. The University of Wisconsin-Madison and the Sandra Rosenbaum School of Social Work occupy ancestral Ho-Chunk land, a place their nation has called Tijab since time immemorial. In an 1832 treaty, the Ho-Chunk were forced to cede this territory. Decades of ethnic cleansing followed when both the federal and state government repeatedly but unsuccessfully sought to forcibly remove the Ho-Chunk from Wisconsin. This history of colonization informs our shared future of collaboration and innovation. Today, UW-Madison respects the inherent sovereignty of the Ho-Chunk Nation along with the 11 other First Nations of Wisconsin. I have just a few more housekeeping details for you and then we'll get started. This presentation is being recorded and will be available on our conference website. To access this presentation, you were required to provide your name and email, and this will allow us to log our attendees and we'll email you information on CEUs for this presentation. So if you're interested in CEUs, stay tuned and those will be distributed via email at a later date. Your cameras and microphones will remain muted during the presentation, and we have a Q&A feature where you can submit questions for our presenters. Please know that due to the large volume of attendees, we probably won't be able to get to all the questions that are submitted, but if you enter those there, we'll get to as many of them as we can at the end of the presentation. And now, without further ado, it's my pleasure to introduce you to our presenters. Erin Barbato is the director of the Immigrant Justice Clinic at the University of Wisconsin Law School. She teaches second and third year law students to represent individuals in removal proceedings and with humanitarian-based immigration relief. In addition, she leads experiential learning opportunities for law students to serve women and children in immigrant detention, as well as people forced to wait in Mexico on migrant protection policies while seeking asylum. Erika Rosales is an undocumented immigrant and a DACA recipient. She's also an immigration activist and has helped organize immigration events and rallies locally and nationally. Erika often speaks out about her experience and knowledge about DACA and immigration as a guest lecturer and through media interviews and published pieces. She currently works at the Wisconsin Center for Education Research as a human resources coordinator and focuses on diversity, equity, inclusion, and social justice. She's done recent work at the Global Health Institute as a human rights curriculum coordinator focusing on migration, child health, and human rights. She recently received her graduate degree from UW-Milwaukee from the Cultural Foundations of Community Engagement and Education program. So we have two phenomenal presenters. I am just delighted that they are joining us. And I'm going to turn it over to you, Erin and Erika. We're all so grateful for your time today.
Thank you so much, Tova. It is such an honor and pleasure to be here and be present at this great conference. I know that Erin and I are extremely passionate about this topic, so I'm honored to be here and especially next to Erin, who I truly admire. Tova mentioned, we're gonna be talking about understanding the impact of racism and white supremacy on the US immigration system in order to better serve people that are undocumented and documented. So this is a roadmap for discussion today. We're gonna be going through quite a little bit of topics within the larger topic. As Erin and I talked about this, we realized that there is so much content here that it would be worthwhile for an actual entire course. But we have, you know, what we have, and so we will definitely work with that. And I know that you already mentioned land acknowledgement, Tova, but this is very much connected to what we're gonna be talking about here. So I want to ask that you join me in another land acknowledgement of the University of Wisconsin and how it is located within the sacred homeland of the Ho-Chunk people, a place that they call the Job. And as the university reaches out and extends through the corners of the state, we respectfully recognize the inherent sovereignty of all the 12 First Nations of Wisconsin, and to acknowledge that this university could not have been established or sustained were it not for the state and federally sponsored settler colonialism that dispossessed and displaced Native American nations and communities across the state. So now we must confront the outcomes of this unjust land treaties and the harm that was caused by the university's past complicity with policies of cultural physical genocide. And we seek to reconciliate with indigenous nations and communities of Wisconsin. So with the spirit of humility and openness, we pledge to do the hard work of reflection and truth telling so that we can move forward to transformative healing. And as we talk about truth-telling, part of that truth-telling is to make sure that we convey the deep-rooted white supremacy that is present in this country and how it is connected to our current reality. There is a complex yet strong connection between migration to the U.S. as well as the current U.S. immigration system and the historical context of indigenous land. As colonizers stole the land from its indigenous people, it also created what we see today when we think of migration, such as displacement, unfairness, insecurity of basic needs, and family separation. Creating spatial boundaries in indigenous land was a way to recreate the indigenous perspective of space. Colonialism, as a form of white supremacy, utilize power to create boundaries, properties, and mark the context of its power and physical form. As soon as the boundaries were created by colonizers, everything that was part of that land was never the same. What was once a container of indigenous ancestral knowledge, teachings, stories, cultures, ways of being, was forcibly removed just like its people. Also, let's keep in mind that the United States is not alone in being a country that once belonged to indigenous people of that land. European colonialism led to the extraction of so many things: rich resources, land repossession, indigenous genocide, and slavery. But most of all, it aimed to destruct the way of living of indigenous peoples through their culture, spirituality, land, language, norms, and ways of being. And tying this to migration, in the case of Latin America, for example, which is also indigenous land of many, such as the Mayan, the Mixteca, Zapoteca, Nahua, Otomi, Mazahua, Perepecha, Guarani, and many, many other groups, it is just like the United States. Since the European conquest, most countries have been subordinated in Latin America to other powers that have been external, such as Spain, Portugal, Great Britain, France, and more recently, the United States and Canada. And over time, the integration of Latin American economies to the global capitalistic system has been accompanied by an increased investment within those countries of transnational corporations in the regions, as well as increased control of the transnational financial institutions over the local markets. And some of the examples here are foreign interventions. So that would be US military intervention as an example. Foreign investment, such as the various countries that have foreign investment in Latin America, like China, Spain, Italy, Germany, and as I mentioned earlier, the US and Canada as more recent. Then privatization. With this, there has been an ongoing privatization in Latin America, especially of natural resources like land, water, crops, and oil. And the disparity in landings, since the beginning of colonialism, there has been has been mainly affected those in rural areas, especially with indigenous people, as they continue to lose their land to private companies. And then due to the climate change, foreign investment and privatization, there continues to be an ongoing environmental degradation in the land. Latin America has a very rich soil in other countries that have been colonized, which produces endless types of crops. However, environmental degradation is shifting the landscape and production. And then wars in Latin America have devastated the people and the economy, and it also produced other problems. For example, El Salvador, and how the US-led civil war resulted in the current gang crisis. So when we think of countries that have had a large influx of migration to the United States, in recent years, we see just a few examples here that go beyond colonialism and they have direct ties to the United States, to be specific. So it is no coincidence that Mexico and the Northern Triangle, which are Honduras, El Salvador, and Guatemala, have been countries with really heavy migration as a result of these examples that have created a major detriment in these countries. In Guatemala, for example, there was a civil war that started in the 1960s and ended in 1996. And then that continued on within that time frame and beyond with the Mayan genocide of Mayan indigenous people of the 1980s, which continued as genocide and then also as mistreatment. In Mexico, there's connections again beyond the European conquest, such as the revolution of 1910, the Bracero program, which Erin will talk about a little bit more. And then also, and again, these are just very few examples, NAFTA, which is the North Atlantic Free Trade Agreement, that came into effect in 1993. And the purpose of it was to boost trade, eliminate barriers, and reduce tariffs on imports and exports between Canada, the United States, and Mexico. However, Mexico, the losing end, as you can see at the bottom of the graph there, where the line of Mexico is. So Mexico's poverty has drastically increased as a result of this agreement. In one analysis, it was pointed out that about 55 of today's Mexicans cannot afford basic expenses. And this goes beyond COVID, such as food, housing, healthcare, education, transportation, and clothing, which is up 52% from the beginning of the agreement, which may not sound like a whole lot, but it amounts to an additional 20 million Mexicans living under these conditions. And with that connection, I will pass it over to Erin.
Thank you, Erika, and thank you everyone for being here today to learn about this topic that Erika and I find is incredibly important. And it's an honor to be here with Erika, who is truly one of my heroines. Anyway, so we wanna look at the historical connection to current reasons for migration. And then I'm gonna link it to what our current laws allow people to do in order to come to the United States, and then discuss why so many of our laws are rooted in white supremacy and why the current structure of our laws really favors people who continues to favor people who are white because of our history. And we couldn't include every single act by the United States that excluded people because of their race, nationality, or origin. But we hope that this summary will help enlighten some of the current situations that we have in the United States. So as Erika mentioned, we have push factors. So people coming to the United States for certain reasons. Some of those might be poverty, crime, violence, food insecurity, or lack of opportunities. Our laws make space for some people who have those issues, who are immigrating because of those issues. So that's more of like a forced migration is how we look at it. And there's also opportunity migration. When we look at opportunity migration, that often will be someone coming to the United States that's permitted under our laws. But because of the history of our immigration laws, those opportunities to come in line, as people will say, people should just get in line to come to the United States. Those lines are very limited, and there is not a line for everyone. So let's talk a little bit about the current immigration process and law. As you can see through the history of our country, the countries that have, the people from different countries around the world who have immigrated to the United States has changed substantially throughout our history since we've started limiting the number of people that can come to the United States. So how can someone enter the United States? Not everybody can enter the United States. That's something. There isn't a general visa. There isn't a way that people can just come from any country with any passport to enter the United States. It's very, very specific categories with really high standards. You can enter the United States as a US citizen. So if you're a US citizen, you use your passport and you can come to the United States. You can leave and re-enter, obviously different under the pandemic, but that is one option. Some people will have the opportunity to immigrate to the United States on this immigrant visa. And I'll talk a little bit about how someone can obtain an immigrant visa, but it's very specific, limited number of people to come to the United States. Some people may also be able to come to the United States on a non-immigrant visa. So a non-immigrant visa is someone coming to the United States for a very specific reason for a specific amount of time. And you have to show that you have what's called non-immigrant intent, meaning you're not coming to the United States to stay, you're coming for that specific reason. So I included a little picture of Disney World. So that would be an example of a non-immigrant visa. So a B2 tourist visa. But that is not available to many people because you generally have to show that you have substantial financial means outside of the United States, a home, a job, family, to demonstrate that you have this non-immigrant intent. People also enter the United States in an undocumented manner. And I use the word undocumented because no human being can be illegal. A person can become undocumented by entering the United States without authorization or remaining in the United States after entering with a valid visa. So again, these are the status. What are the status of people in the United States? So it depends on the protections you have and the future you have in the United States all depends on what status you have. So US citizens have the most rights. They are protected the most by the Constitution and under our laws. Lawful permanent residents, people who may enter on an immigrant visa or get that status, in the United States have some rights as well, but they are subject to deportation. If something happens to them, they may lose that status. It is not permanent. Then we also have non-immigrants. Non-immigrants may be here to work, may be here to visit, may be here to study. Again, subject to removal. And then we have this population, this 11 million people who are undocumented. They have the least rights. And also, as we tried to illustrate here, often have to live in the shadows because of the laws and the policies in our country. So why is US citizenship so important? So you saw that Sorry that the sun is like coming at my head in a strange way, but hopefully you can still hear me okay. So U.S. citizenship, why is that so important? Becoming a U.S. citizen means you have full protection of the laws. It means you can have a U.S. passport, you have the right to vote, the right to run for public office, eligibility for certain federal employment benefits. You can travel abroad for long periods of time and not fear of not being able to re-enter the United States. You can't be deported from the United States. You can also sponsor family to immigrate to the United States. You have and benefits under the tax laws. So many people would like to have the benefit of becoming a U.S. citizen, but the laws throughout our history have made participation in U.S. citizenship incredibly difficult. So who can become a U.S. citizen? A very limited number of people. So by land, you may be able, if you were born in the United States, this is called birthright citizenship. So our country from, if you were born in the United States, despite the status of your parents, you are a U.S. citizen. By blood, if you are born to U.S. citizens abroad or in the United States, but by blood, you may be a U.S. citizen as well. So for if you don't fall in the categories of being born in the United States or being born to U.S. citizens, how can you become a U.S. citizen? Generally, that is going to be through the process of naturalization, an act of law, right? Now, our laws make that very limited, and I'll talk a little bit about that in the next slide. Because in order to naturalize, you have to first become a lawful permanent resident. Lawful permanent resident, meaning these immigrant visas that are issued every year, they're limited in the number. So every year, the United States has a maximum of 480,000 visas, immigrant visas through family members. So for example, a US citizen falls in love with a person from Spain. They may be able to petition for that person to come to the United States. That's called family-based immigration. It sounds straightforward, it is not. It is incredibly difficult. The person who wants to immigrate to the United States, even if their spouse is a U.S. citizen, has very high standards. They basically cannot have made any mistakes during their life. We hold people to incredibly high standards that most U.S. citizens could not meet. There's also employment-based immigrant visas. So people can come here sponsored by their employer. 140,000 are available every year. High education, generally, professional degrees, high skill level, it's really high level. And people who are in the United States in an undocumented way are not eligible for employment-based visas. So they're barred from receiving that opportunity. We have humanitarian-based visas that maybe allow people to become lawful permanent residents because they're survivors of certain crimes, or if they maybe are seeking asylum. That is a road to citizenship. And that varies every day, not every day, but every year mostly. And also the number of refugees that our country permits to enter the United States. The executive office decides how many refugees can come to the United States. This past year, we had the lowest number of refugees admitted into the United States since the law began in 1980. President Biden just announced that he will be processing 125,000 refugees into the United States in this fiscal year. So it's a change, a swing in the opposite direction, but still 125,000 is not a historical high. We also have this group of diversity visas. So it's truly people can play a lottery to see if they can become a lawful permanent resident in the United States if you're from an underrepresented country. So in our laws, we do currently have this to diversify our country, but in actuality, it doesn't always work that way. So now I want to talk a little bit about the history of these laws. How did we get here? What are the roots of them? And why is white supremacy such a highlighted theme throughout? From the beginning of time, it's explicit. And now we can still see it, the remnants of it in our laws, even though it may not say white only. So our first citizenship law was from 1970, and it included the words free white persons. And free white persons meant that anybody who had been in the United States for 2 years who was a free white person, meaning a free white man, could become a US citizen. A few years later, that changed to the 5 years. So someone who had residency for 5 years could then naturalize, still limited to white men. This excluded Native Americans, indentured servants, and both people that were enslaved by these white people and free Black people in the United States. The Treaty of Guadalupe from 1848 is not often discussed, but it's when, after the Mexican-American War, where the US took Mexican land. So areas of Texas, California, New Mexico, Arizona, anybody who had been living there as a Mexican citizen was then automatically placed under the jurisdiction of the United States. That was not by choice, that was by situation. One of the first acts of the United States issuing and taking control of people from Mexico without their choice. So after the Civil War, that citizenship law of 1790 did change. And we opened through the 14th Amendment, the US laws extended citizenship to all persons born in the United States. That's what it said, the citizenship clause. All persons born or naturalized in the United States. But the 14th Amendment did still precluded Native Americans from citizenship and its benefits, and precluded many other groups from citizenship, such as Chinese and other Asians. There was still a lot of misinformation and fighting against Black people and people of African descent of becoming US citizens for many years, even after the 14th Amendment. So during the Naturalization Act of 1870, our government made it explicit. Aliens, which is a term I don't choose to use, it's written in our laws right now. President Biden is trying to eliminate that in our laws and change that word. But aliens of African nativity and to persons of African descent, but it still continued to deny rights to other groups of non-whites, particularly Asians. So when I mentioned Asians in this past slide, this is a group of people that were continuously barred from the United States for many years. And so the Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882 was one of the first laws that specifically mentioned a nationality to exclude. So the Chinese Exclusion Act forbid people from China from entering the United States. But this was a time when there was a need for workers in the United States. So at the time of the Chinese Exclusion Act, we saw the creation of a profession or of the coyotes. So Americans needed workers. And so they people started charging to bring people from China into the United States. So our law started endangering people. And another expression of how the labor market has created discrepancies and danger to people from other countries while we desire to have them work here in the United States to improve our country. So there was continued exclusion of Native Americans from citizenship until 1924. Then we finally enacted the Indian Citizenship Act on June 2nd of that year to finally allow people in this country to become US citizens. That took a very long time. That same year in 1924, we saw a change in terms of favoring Western and Northern Europeans. Again, this National Origin Act, when we look at these slides, we can see from 1820 to 1889, most of the immigration was coming from Western Europe. During the next years of 1890 to 1920, we saw a huge shift. So a larger number from Southern and Eastern Europe. The US government did not like this. So our legislature changed the laws from the National Origins Act of 1920, not to reflect 1820 to 1920, but to reflect the time when there were more people coming from Western Europe, so 1820 to 1889. And that had a significant effect on who could be permitted into our country. People from Western and Northern Europe continued to be favored in an explicit manner. Now, Erika mentioned this a little bit before, but we created this Bracero program during World War II. There was a need for workers in the United States. So we offered, there were about 4 million visas, work visas offered to people from Mexico to come and work in the United States. That was not a road to citizenship. That was not a protected class or a way for anybody to remain in the United States permanently. It was a way for the United States to benefit from the work of Mexicans. Shortly thereafter the Bracero program started, we created a different program called termed within our laws, Operation Wetback. Those were the words that were used to deport people who are on the Bracero program or other people in the United States who are from Mexico without authorization. They use military style tactics to remove Mexicans and even some US citizens that had brown skin. We started using national security as a reason to harm people from different races and different nationalities, including we exerted the use of detention centers for Japanese people during World War II through an executive order. And we've probably heard a lot about this in the news, use of executive order. The president, the executive has a lot of power under our national security to treat certain individuals based on race or nationality in a certain way if it's for national security. Now the picture here of one of these detention centers, internment camps, is very similar to some of the family detention centers and children detention centers that we have today. Tents set up in underpopulated areas with very little protection from oversight from other people. Another area where we use national security to harm people is we denied refuge to Jewish people fleeing the Nazi government. We said that our government thought that people who are fleeing for refuge in the United States because of persecution and torture were turned away at our borders because under our laws, we didn't have protection. And we used the term national security to turn away people who were the ones that were being persecuted. Now, in reaction to that, we did create the 1951 Refugee Convention, which was supposed the world coming together to say, we're not gonna send people back to places where they will be persecuted. So a lot of our asylum and refugee laws are based on this 1951 Refugee Convention. It was a way for the world to come together and say, we're not going to allow certain countries to torture and persecute their citizens, and we will offer protection in many different countries around the world, including the United States. And those laws have been on the books for a long time, codified mostly in 1980. But since 1980, laws truly have not changed very much in terms of providing protection for people seeking refuge. But over the past 4 years, we saw a huge wall being built by policies under the Trump administration. These are a few photographs that I took while I did do some work in Tijuana, where people were forced to remain during something called migrant protection protocols or through a process called metering. It was a way that we, even though our laws didn't change, policies by this former administration really put up structure to forbid people from seeking asylum that is permissible under our laws from entering the United States and having due process. So metering, we forced everyone who attempted to apply for asylum on the southern border to wait in line in Mexico, in border towns without protection from really anyone. Migrant protection protocols forced people after they were metered to remain in Mexico. Right now, as of today, there are 25,000 people in the migrant protection protocols waiting on our southern border. President Biden did announce today that he is going to start processing people so that on this migrant protection protocols so that they can safely process for asylum in the United States living with friends and family. It's a very difficult process, obviously, during a pandemic, but it's a move in the right direction. Trump also had the Safe Third Country transit ban, which barred anybody from seeking asylum on our southern border if they passed through a third country on their way, regardless of whether they had protection in that country or if that country even had an asylum system. The Trump administration also eliminated, as much as they, well, they attempted to eliminate domestic violence and gang violence as a ground for seeking asylum. And when Erika mentioned some of the push and pull factors for forced migration, many of these gangs and military issues are rooted in some of the acts of the United States from the past. So in summation, these policy changes really went into effect to bar people from countries in Africa, from countries in Central America, South America, really around the world, from being able to have protection under our laws. And the, you know, the asylum policies were all under the auspiciousness of national security. And we also saw national security be used in this executive order 13769, the Muslim ban, which barred people from coming to the United States from a number of Muslim majority countries and under the name of protecting the nation from foreign terrorist entry into the United States. So xenophobia and discrimination is straight explicit in this as well. And this was something almost 4 years ago today on the anniversary of what happened. We've also used national security as a reason to create immigrant detention centers in the United States. The United States has the largest immigrant detention center in the world. In 2019, the average number of people that were in detention on any given day were 50,000 people. That is the size of Annapolis. It's a small city. And over a year, over 500,000 people are detained. This isn't, people aren't detained in immigrant detention centers while they're serving a criminal sentence. This is civil detention. This is not criminal detention. ICE has the authority to release almost every single person in detention, but they choose to hold people in detention. These numbers have decreased during the pandemic for a number of reasons, but not for humanitarian reasons. Immigrant detention is, often run by private prison companies. So CoreCivic and Geo, the Geo Group, are two billion-dollar companies that profit off of detaining people from other countries, people of color, people from other nationalities under the civil detention. It's a choice. And so they have a financial incentive to have these programs going, having these detention centers going. It's our taxpayers also pay for, our tax dollars also pay for these. So it's something that we really need to be cognizant of. And Biden hasn't ended the contracts with these private prison companies yet for immigrant detention centers. And over the past few years, we have seen some really horrific actions in detention centers, including forced gynecological exams to women, many from Cameroon. We've seen COVID outbreaks in many of the detention centers because it is impossible to have social distance in these detention centers. I personally have had 5 clients who've gotten sick with COVID while in detention centers, while ICE had the authority to release them, but would not do so, even though they had US citizen family members ready and willing to house them. And we've also seen the highest number of deaths in the ICE custody in the past 15 years. So over 20 people have died in ICE custody, really horrific conditions that will hopefully soon be addressed. And we continue to have family and children detention centers. So There are three family detention centers, South Texas Family Residential Center, that detain up to 2,400 women and children seeking refuge in the United States. I do work at this facility, and they are really in prison-like conditions. It's a detention center, not a residential facility. There's also the Berks Detention Center in Pennsylvania, as well as the Carnes Detention Center, which houses men and their children who are detained. And then throughout the United States, as we learned very much through the zero tolerance policy that Erika is going to talk about next, family separation, we have children's detention centers where children without their parents are detained, and also children who were detained after being separated, forcibly separated from their parents on the southern border, remain in detention. So I think this is where Erika takes over.
Thank you so much, Erin. So as Erin was mentioning, and I'm sure as the majority of you know, as the world watched the previous administration tear families apart, separating immigrant children, some folks suggest that Trump supporters and the administration actually aimed at provoking fear among communities of color outside of the United States and within the United States, and sending a very strategic message. So zero tolerance was a deliberate act of white nationalists to create havoc and trauma. And this issue has been a historical one, with slave children being turned away from their mothers and Native children being sent away from boarding schools and also being torn away from their family. Earlier generations also encounter child separation, as we can see in this graphic and in this picture. So this was foundational in slavery. Unfree people were not having permanence of their children was an essential feature that was part of their strategy then, and that is still part of their strategy now. And this strategy has also been utilized in the indigenous communities. So adoption projects, while forcibly removing children from their homes, being stripped away from their homes by the way of social workers, by categorizing families as unfit or neglectful, and having children be adopted into white families while the children were being described in very atrocious ways as unwanted children. So the categorizations were often living with too many family members, while living with an extended family is actually part of Native tradition and not living in the white standard way of being. And these adoption projects efforts were mainly created by state agencies and also private organizations or private religious organizations. Although the Indian Child Welfare Act, or ICWA, of 1977 now pushes for Native families to stay together, or at least within their community, if a child needs to be removed from the family today, Indigenous children are still four times more likely than white children to be placed in foster care, even if they are in a very familiar or in a very similar situation. It's also worth noting that ICWA was protection for Native families. It has been attempted to be overturned by white families and conservative organizations. So here, I wanna show a little bit of I'm gonna stop sharing my screen because I wanna show a video that demonstrates this history in a very specific way. So just give me 1 second and I will. Technology is always the trickiest part. All right.
I was adopted by a white missionary couple.
I was adopted.
Immediately placed for adoption.
I was in foster care with one family for 18 years. They were white.
My parents loved us, and I understand that, but at the same time,
they took the idea that they were saving me.
Saving us. from ourselves.
Being saved, and I should be grateful for the life that I've been given, because any child on the reservation would give anything to live as I was living.
They took us away from our mom. They came marching right in and literally took us and thousands of other children from their home.
It's a way to eradicate us, and to go to a nation's children is one of the sure ways to do that.
The U.S. has a long and brutal legacy of attempting to eradicate Native Americans. For centuries, they colonized Native American lands and murdered their populations. They forced them west and pushed them into small, confined patches of land. But Native Americans resisted. A Board of Indian Commissioners report said, instead of dying out under the light and contact of civilization, the Indian population is steadily increasing. And that was an obstacle to total American expansion. So the U.S. found a new solution to absorb and assimilate them. It all started with an experiment and a man named Richard Henry Pratt.
He had in his charge some prisoners of war, and he taught these men how to speak English, how to read and write, and how to do labor. He dressed them in military uniforms and basically ran an assimilation experiment. And then he took his results to the federal government and said, they're capable of being civilized. So he was able to get this project funded.
In 1879, the government funded Pratt's project, the first ever off-reservation boarding school for Native American children. His motto was to kill the Indian and save the man. What started there at the Carlisle Indian Industrial School was nothing short of genocide disguised as American education. Children were forcibly taken from reservations and placed into the school, hundreds, even thousands of miles away from their families. They were stripped of their traditional clothing. Their hair was cut short. They were given new names and forbidden from speaking their native languages.
To take our children and to indoctrinate them into Western society, to take away their identity as indigenous peoples, their tribal identity. I think it's one of the most effective and insidious ways that the U.S. did do harm to indigenous peoples here, because it targeted our children, our most vulnerable. And they tried to make us ashamed for being Indian, and they tried to make us something other than Indian.
There are also accounts of mental, physical, and sexual abuse, of forced manual labor, neglect, starvation, and death.
My great-grandfather went to Carlisle, and nobody in my family ever talked about it. So if you Google Indian boarding schools, the majority of the pictures that you will see will be actually from Carlisle. Colonel Pratt created propaganda. He hired a photographer to create those before and after photos to show that his experiment was working. So it was, you know, intentional propaganda.
And it worked.
So I'm actually going to show another video just to demonstrate how this intentional way of separating children is still used today as part of this strategy. So just give me 1 second. I lost my other.
So you
Sorry about that.
You said you cried all the time because you weren't with your father anymore.
I was separated from him.
Separada de él.
I was taken.
Es difícil no hablar de esto. ¿Por qué?
Porque extraño.
Because I miss my dad a lot.
You miss him a lot.
Sí.
It took you where all the children were.
Sí.
These are the faces of families torn apart.
If you cross the border unlawfully, then we will prosecute you.
I asked them to please don't separate us because my little brother was crying. And seeing him cry destroyed me and made me cry too. Then I didn't see him again.
When separation of children.
Let me try that again, just 1 second.
A lot.
You miss him.
I was taken.
Es difícil no hablar de él. Obviamente.
And seeing him cry destroyed me and made me cry too.
No me dijo nada. Luego.
Then I didn't see him again.
When separation of children and parents started as a systematic policy, you just see shock, you see pain, you see terror, you see desperation.
These are today's immigrants, four families caught in a web of policy and politics.
Zero tolerance for criminal aliens. Zero, zero.
United States, if you break the law, you go to jail and you're separated from your family. It shouldn't be any different for illegal immigrants.
It was extremely hard to explain to my son what was happening to him.
To Papa, was he able to say bye to you? Did he explain what was happening?
No.
In the video call with my daughter, she couldn't speak.
Porque ella solo lloraba.
Because she was just crying.
Yo sentía que...
I felt she was crying. Tears of blood.
¿Sabe que los hijos?
You know, your kids are the most important thing in life. God gives you children, and you have to fight for them.
And I'm sorry. I don't know how many times I've watched those videos, but it's still really difficult to watch them. As I was mentioning, the trauma that we can see with these children and families, it's very intentional as a deterrent. And we can see... I wanted to show another video that demonstrates this this trauma just as an example. It's a very short video. Here we go.
Yo le dije por ti, mi amor, dime.
Let me just get back to my PowerPoint. Just one second here.
While Erika is working on getting me,
I
was just gonna say that, you know, we work with a number of families that have been, were forcibly separated, some still separated, and some of the people that have been the most intricate in the healing process and in helping these families have been social workers. So if any of you have interest in getting involved in that way, there's such a huge need. So I'll mute again, but Eddie gets back.
Thank you, Erin. I'm telling you, technology. and even as, you know, this video is an example of, this is a video of a family reuniting. So one would think that, you know, families are being reunited and it should be a joyful moment. However, it's not. It's traumatic to see that child not wanted to really interact with his mother or their mother. And that is just the cause, that is the end result of all of these policies, that they have long lasting effects on human beings and all of our lives. And as I move into this, as I was mentioning how most people were up in arms when we saw the families being separated, and that is because it was very visible. However, what we don't see is the day-to-day trauma that is very present for the rest of the undocumented and documented population. So this was actually a survey that I completed as being as a DACA recipient. And as I was filling it out, I was reminded of all of the trauma that we have to live just by the mere fact of being undocumented. And this is an every single day thing that is very present in the back of our minds. So I saw these questions and the amount of fear that is in each one of them, they feel kind of heavy. And overall, they encompass the removal of our power and our voice and our humanity. And all of that is very much still, it lives within our bodies, our mind, and our spirit. And it's something that is a constant basis. And also the being documented, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. I am documented, so I have DACA as this protection. I'm still considered undocumented by legal standards, but I have this protection from deportation. And in order for me to do that, the standards are so incredibly high, on top of having to navigate a bunch of barriers. And the standards are, as Erin said, you know, they're standards that oftentimes citizens cannot meet. So for me, for example, it was incredibly difficult to get my master's degree on top of the many requirements, as you know, most of you know, that students have. There's also the barriers that undocumented students have, especially here in Wisconsin. We don't have access to in-state tuition. And that means that each course it's going to be completely different of the amount we're going to have to pay. So this is a receipt of my tuition for two courses. And also let me mention that as undocumented folks, we're not eligible for FAFSA and we're excluded for most scholarships. And now there's a little bit more, I've seen more scholarships out there, but a lot of them were for undergrad students. So I was excluded from a lot of that because they often believe, which is my belief, I believe that first we're not going to apply to get higher education, and especially to go even higher than that to get our master's or PhD. So those of us that have DACA, which is, I mentioned, protection from deportation, we're able to have certain things. I want to call them privileges, but because they feel like a privilege when you've been undocumented for so long. And so meaning that before this, I did not have this. I did not have what I have now, which is a driver's license, a work permit, a social security number, which, you know, for those that have it, probably it doesn't seem like a whole lot, but having those things allows us to have so much more. And again, we're still considered undocumented because DACA is not a permanent solution. And we've seen this in the past 8 years. DACA has been threatened multiple times. And some of us have had to put, you know, our lives at risk for fighting for, not just for ourselves, but for others that that have DACA. And I honestly don't believe that there's gonna be a way out of this until there's a permanent solution. And so, let me actually pass it over to Erin so she can talk a little bit more about that.
So Erika, thank you for sharing and for all you do. I saw a few questions in the chat about what is the Biden administration going to do. So when we look at kind of back at our history, we do have a history of sometimes offering people like temporary protection, and that really is what DACA is. It is a temporary reprieve from the fear of deportation. But the person that is always in charge of that temporary reprieve is the person in the executive office. So President Trump tried every which way to dismantle DACA and to cancel it, to terminate it. He wasn't able to do that because he terminated it in an incorrect manner, according to the Supreme Court. That being said, we now have one of Biden's first executive orders was to strengthen and fortify DACA. That means that it's DACA as it continues. The executive doesn't have the power to create a pathway to citizenship, most legal scholars say, for a pathway to citizenship for people with DACA. And then in the next slide, I'm going to talk about what is proposed as a possible permanent solution, being the Citizenship Act of 2021 and why that's so important. But the executive orders thus far, oh, sorry, can you go back to the other slide, Erika? Sorry, I'm hard to manage. but I want to talk a little bit about some of the movements of the Biden administration thus far do have a movement towards anti-racism and less xenophobia within them. So he's enhancing the refugee resettlement program and expanding the impact of climate change on migration. As I mentioned before, increasing the numbers of refugees around the world that can find refuge in the United States to 125,000 people this year. Looking at the southern border and the asylum system that was torn apart under the Trump administration. So how do we find a more humane process for people seeking asylum, where people are not putting their lives in further danger by seeking refuge that's permissible under our laws? We saw in one of the videos, I think it was former AG Jeff Sessions said, you know, if you break the laws, you come into the United States, we're going to take your children. If you enter the United States without authorization and you seek asylum, that's not unlawful. That is 100% lawful under our asylum law. So it's really important for people to also understand what is permissible in the language that we use. Because if we can dehumanize and criminalize the process of survival, which has been done for the past 4 years. So Biden has a lot to do in order to just get us back to out of a negative humanitarian situation. So he's looking at the southern border. He's established an interagency task force on reunification of families. I'm sure many of you have questions about that. They have 120 days to come up with a plan, and it's headed by the head of DHS, Mayorkas, who will work to reunite families. And in some situations, that's gonna be bringing parents who are deported without their children back to the United States. And he did say even this morning that they are gonna work towards that to ensure that there is no family that is left without being reunified. That being said, in certain situations, reunification will not be possible. Many of these parents entered the United States to seek refuge because they were being persecuted in the United States and were left with the only choice of allowing their child to stay in the United States and have protection if they were deported. And if some of them that were deported were persecuted and tortured and may not may no longer be with us, or may be too scared to talk to the US government because of everything that happened to them because of losing a child. So this process is going to be incredibly difficult, but it has started at least. There's an executive order to restore faith in our immigration system and promote integration of new Americans. The Trump administration made every single process of entering the United States, even under our laws, more difficult. And there are families that have remained separated because of this. And this task force is to help increase the processes that are available. I talked about the memorandum on preserving and fortifying DACA, and then revising the civil immigration enforcement policy and priorities, meaning under the Trump administration, everybody who was in the United States undocumented was a priority. ICE, everyone who was in the United States undocumented, including people with DACA, over 650,000 people in the United States lived in fear of ICE knocking on their door. These priorities will change under Biden. To protect United States people in the United States from terrorism and other civil unrest, but will hopefully be more fair and cause fewer family separations. Because we look at how the zero tolerance policy separated families, ICE separates families deliberately every day as well. It's the same thing in a lot of ways. So, and then ending discriminatory bans on entry to the United States. That was the Muslim ban. So the Muslim ban, the executive order that created that has now been terminated. So now those were policies. So those are things that are under the executive's power to change. Now I wanna talk about Biden's proposal of the Citizenship Act of 2021, which again, I think moves in towards an anti-racist movement under our laws. It eliminates, as I said, the word alien in our laws. And it's a Citizenship Act of 2021. And it has a number of factors, but Biden can't pass this on his own. This needs to be an act of law, so by Congress. And so it's gonna take a lot of effort for this to get passed, but I wanna explain a lot of the things that I think are really important and have the opportunity to change a flawed system that really was based on white supremacy. And this is a movement in the right direction. It is by no means perfect. Nobody is perfect, but I do think there's a lot of incredibly thoughtful components of it. One of the most important parts is a pathway to citizenship for undocumented workers. That also includes an expedited process for people with DACA, meaning if this passes, people with DACA would be able to become citizens within 3 years. And the reason that is so important is because we know that the executive can change DACA. So this would allow everyone with DACA, if they're eligible, to become citizens under this administration. Now the pathway for the other 11 million people who are here in the United States, or about 10 million people, that would be an 8-year path. That is a longer path with a possible change in administration, which I think is imperfect, but is clearly much better than it is today, because so many of the 11 million people don't have a pathway to citizenship because of the restrictionist policies that we've had from the past. They were often based on race, nationality, or criminalization of things that really are not, shouldn't have been criminalized. He'll increase employment-based visas and green cards, a worker protection and employment verification program, look at that and make it better. Review some of the process for asylum, like including that people who are seeking asylum must apply within 1 year of entering the United States. That would change. And it would be a more humane process, as well as looking at border security, but in a way that doesn't criminalize additional people or harm additional populations. He'll look at improving immigration courts. There's an incredibly long backlog right now in immigration courts. Over a million cases are pending. And also then thoughtfully addressing the root causes of migration. So this would also, a proposal would allow certain people in Central America to apply for asylum from abroad and then process a refugee status from abroad and then process in the United States so they wouldn't have to take a dangerous journey and put their lives at further risk. So in order for this to pass, it has to be an act of Congress, as I mentioned before. And so while again, it's a movement in the right direction, and I think it has, will be, allow so many people to have safety that have been living in the shadows for so many years, you know, it's the right thing to do. And I also think, as we look at, we want a more just system where there isn't the ability to separate families or to cause further trauma on people living in the United States. This is one way that's gonna make an incredible difference. So you guys might, we're gonna have some time for questions at the end, but I wanna turn it over to Erika to talk a little bit more like what you can do.
Thank you, Erin. So yes, what can we do? So first, we need to have government needs to hear from the general population. So we've seen the outcome of this with the end of zero tolerance policy. There was a huge push from the general population for that policy to end. So it is much more powerful when we hear or when they hear from the general population that from instead of when they hear from folks like Erin and myself, because there is a lot of power in that. Folks must demand that the U.S. respect treaties of human rights, which include the right to migrate in a safe and humane way. Also, voting for policymakers that are anti-racist and are looking at migration and immigration from a humane standpoint. And this is at the local, state, and federal level. And as a country, we need to have a permanent solution, not just for DACA recipients, but also for the 11 million undocumented people that are part of this country. And actually, let me put that. And then also on the individual level, there are so many things people can do. You can write an op-ed. Actually, Erin and I have created a list of resources that we'll share with you all, just because this is such a complex issue and there's so much to talk about here. So we're gonna share a Google document that has a bunch of resources. It's in one of them, aside from the, there's videos, articles, organizations, local organizations and national organizations that are around immigration. And then there's also toolkits. And then there's also action steps of writing something like writing an op-ed, especially if you're a social worker, that it's gonna make a pretty big difference. Also contacting national NGOs, local media to see if they're covering these stories, and then contacting people you know to take collective political action, which can still be done even with COVID. Attending community meetings, town halls and events. And then connecting this very closely to your field of work. So see what ways your knowledge can impact the work, and also request professional development and trainings on how to properly serve undocumented immigrants, because it can be quite complicated. There is stigma. So there are some people like myself who are open about our status, but there's a lot of people that are not, and rightfully so. There's a lot of fear in you know, having this type of information out and about, because we've seen how much people can be affected if something goes awry. And then knowledge is power. So knowledge is power, and the knowledge with action is so much more powerful. So we can utilize that action to be magnified, because when we put that together with the resources and everything that we have on hand, we can create a huge difference. And that is a link to the Google Doc. I will share it on the chat. And then we just want to thank you. And hopefully we still have a little bit of time for questions. Oh yeah, okay, 15 minutes. I'm so proud of us. I will stop sharing my screen so that Erin and I can take some questions. And also, by the way, since I talk about my story, I don't feel any hesitance in answering any questions that you might have about my personal story. So Tova, if you wanna take it, I don't know if you want to moderate the questions.
I was just gonna ask you if you would like me to pull out some questions for you.
Yeah, that would be great.
So there are a couple of questions about language, about using undocumented versus without status is one question.
I can start by answering that, and then I'd love to hear what Erika has to say too. But Erika and I were also talking about this a little bit. And it's something that's really important, language and how we use words, and especially always using person first language, I think is incredibly important. I often in the work that I do, because I work with people who are detained, and we'll hear an immigration custom enforcement officer or even other lawyers say, oh, this detainee is getting deported today. This detainee is getting released today. You know, this detainee is a human being. And so that is always what is first. So this person who is in detention, or this person who is undocumented, the person who is unauthorized. And it's complicated in terms of what is the right word. We know for sure that using the term illegal or using the term alien are dehumanizing. And that is a really powerful tool for people who want to dehumanize populations. So the better we can be at putting person first language to always recognize the human being and not the situation, which oftentimes the situation is not of choice, but of forced nature of what's going on outside of the world, I think is incredibly important. And then Erika, I don't know if you have more to add to that.
Yes, I love that. when you are being dehumanized, it can be done so in so many different ways. And I think words and titles and anything that describes us does so powerfully. And I think it does so intentionally. So I think we can reverse that, or as much as we can, with using terms that bring the humanity back. Because oftentimes, even within our communities, we start to believe those messages that we are illegal, that we are criminals, and then creating more harm within us that's already been there. There's already so much harm that has been done. So something like a word that brings back that humanity and just acknowledges that the whole aspect of the human is really powerful. So yeah, thank you, Erin.
Thank you. So there's a question, and you started to address this a little bit already, Erin, but if either of you want to add, talking about future directions for the Biden administration to take, both what they're doing and where you see the biggest need for continued action or for change compared to where we've been with policy.
Yeah, I think, I mentioned a few of this administration has done thus far everything they have promised to do, but it's not gonna be just this administration. It has to be the power of the people. And Erika mentioned that. If our government doesn't know that the will of the people is behind supporting the 11 million people that are undocumented, it's not gonna change. We have to use our voices. So everybody who went out and protested against family separation should be doing the same thing and protesting and supporting a movement towards this more humane immigration system to right many of the wrongs that we have had in the past that have left people out, people that are very much an intricate part of our communities, to end family separation in general within our interior as well. They're working really hard, I think, by announcing this morning that they're starting to process people in the migrant protection protocols. That is certainly a move in the right direction, but every day that someone is stuck in migrant protection protocols or separated from their family, that is a day of danger for that family. And so there's a sense of urgency, and the layer of the pandemic is incredibly difficult. So I am incredibly sympathetic to that. They have a really hard job to do, but that being said, we still need to continue to push this administration to do as much as possible, because the things that have been done over the past 4 years truly have been horrific.
Thank you. Do you want to add to that, Erika, or are you ready for next question? Okay.
Next one.
Thanks. So there are a couple of questions, and you've offered a lot of resources, and I'll point out that Erika added to the chat the list of resources that she mentioned, so that's available to everyone listening. But a couple of questions that are around how we can get involved as social workers, and specifically how to make a difference and support families and individuals.
If I can start, I would say that with knowledge is the first step, only because it can be quite intricate to support undocumented, someone who's undocumented. And if you don't know, you might cause harm. So I would say that that is the first step. And if people don't know, I think that there are folks that are open and available to answer questions. And there's a lot of organizations that do professional development, and it can be done so in a different way. You know, it can be something that is just learning the history, learning why people from specific countries have fled or have come, and then also what it means to be, to not have status. Like what does it mean related to the work that you do? As the closer that you can link it to the work that you do, I think that the better, and that way that you'll be able to utilize that knowledge. And also keeping in mind that policies, when it comes to immigration, policies change all the time. And I'm sure this is something that you have all noticed, but they change very rapidly. So even if you learn about a certain policy, that might change within you know, a certain amount of time. So that's just something to keep in mind as well.
Thank you. So I'm going to just address one question briefly that came up about the access to the Google Docs, and say that Erika has let us know that if you have trouble accessing it, I think there's an option to request access. And if you click on that, she'll make sure that you can access. Mm-hmm. So next question for you both. Somebody asked about if there are any support systems in place for professionals and community advocates who are doing this work. And she writes that 3 years ago, she volunteered at a detention center for children and would like to connect with others who've had similar experiences.
I think that's a really good question. And I think that's a resource that I don't know about, but probably should be available. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, trauma-informed lawyering is something that we work on and what we're doing, but it's kind of a newer practice. And I think I don't have a good answer to this because, you know, there's a lot of listservs and things we do. But I think there's an opportunity to make space for this. I think it would be really helpful, especially with people from a social work background. There's such a need for your knowledge and your skill. You're such an intricate part of this process for not only the people that are coming to the United States, but people that are supporting people in these situations. Mm-hmm. Erika, do you know of anything that I'm missing?
No, you know, what I've noticed is the majority of folks who are involved with immigration issues that connected to their workplace are people that are just individually interested and passionate about helping, but I don't think that there's any like professional connection other than, you know, when things come up. I'm Voces de la Frontera, I think, is a kind of a unifying force within Wisconsin. And we do have some other local ones like Centro Hispano and other organizations, but I think that one of the biggest ones is Voces de la Frontera. Voces de la Frontera is on the list of resources that we have on there.
Great. So there's a question. Somebody is asking if you could say anything about how many people are coming, attempting to move to the U.S. seeking asylum or refugee status. It says versus the number that attempt to enter without accessing the current channels in place. So I think trying to get a sense of kind of the distribution of ways in which people are entering or seeking to enter.
You know, it's a really good question. And as I tried to explain in the presentation, is people seeking asylum over the past 4 years really were barred from doing so. Almost every single person arriving at the southern border, unless you were from Mexico, you were barred from getting asylum if you passed through another country on the way to the United States. So those numbers simply aren't available right now and would be very difficult to decipher what they mean. Many people prior to the Trump administration, you can go to a port of entry and you basically knock, this is, you know, you don't knock on a door, but you kind of do, and say, I would like to present myself for asylum. And then you go through a process that's under our laws, starting with a credible fear interview. And then after that, you're generally placed into detention. Some people are released from detention to family members or friends, if there's, or even sponsors. So certain U.S. citizens or lawful permanent residents can sponsor asylum seekers as well in their homes. And there are a few, where we live in Madison, there are a few families that do that and have offered a really incredible amount of safety to a few individuals. But in terms of numbers, because we cut off our refugee numbers, the 125,000 people that Biden is now allowing to process for refugee status in the United States, over the past 4 years, those numbers have been at a below 20,000 in this past year, under 10,000, while the number of refugees around the world has never been higher since World War II. So in terms of specific numbers, it's really difficult to articulate what those numbers are, but the situation has made it incredibly difficult for anybody to even apply for asylum.
Mm-hmm. So I think we're going to do just one more question, and I'm going to first thank everyone for the questions and apologize that we're not getting to all of them, but I have a few words to say to wrap us up at the end. So I want to ask one more question, and then we'll move into that kind of closing phase. And so, Erika, I'm wondering, people have asked if we had a little bit of time, if you could just speak briefly to your own experience a little bit in terms of both obstacles and helpful experiences.
Sure. I know we don't have a lot of time, but I think that one of the main obstacles is stigma, because when there's stigma, it's really hard to be free, and it's traumatizing to be labeled as something and for people not to understand something that affects one personally, but also people that I care about or that we care about. I think that the other is just lack of resources. There's a huge lack of resources. I mean, I mentioned at the university level for those of us who, you know, want to get a higher education, the university does not have a whole lot of resources for undocumented students. And there's a bunch of barriers for those of us who have attempted to get a higher education. So there's like barriers and barriers within every structure that we look at, whether it's education, driving. I have a driver's license, but again, I only have it for a certain amount of time. So I have it for like about a year and a half until I renew my DACA. And if that doesn't renew, actually, I can't even get a traffic violation because that might go against my next renewal. So I think that the things that most people don't really think about, I have to be very conscientious of every day. And especially because I'm one of the few people in my family that has that privilege of having a driver's license. So I have to think about them and how things may affect them. If they want to go somewhere, if they want to go out of town, then I have to drive. If they want to get something, then I have to be the one getting it for them. I think people who have been super supportive have been just incredible. And I don't know that I would be here, honestly, with people without the people that have offered me support. And I think the majority of the people that have offered me support, as I mentioned, are the people who are really knowledgeable, or as knowledgeable as possible with these topics, which is very difficult. Immigration is probably one of the most intricate topics that one can find. But I think that people, when you understand how complex it is and how the majority of folks who leave their country is not by choice, who put their lives and their children at risk is not by choice. It is very intentional, and not leaving often means death, often means starvation, often means being taken and put into prostitution, being put in cartels, like things that we can't even imagine here in the United States. So I think that just having that knowledge and empathy from folks is quite major. And I could say a whole lot more, but I know that we're pretty short on time. So I wanna recognize that.
Thank you so much, Erika. And I hate to cut this short when what you're saying is so important and valuable for all of us to hear. So I want to take just a minute, since we are at the end of our time, to say a huge, huge thank you to Erika and Erin for sharing your time, your expertise with us, all the information you've shared. There's a lot of appreciation in the comments for you both and the work that you do and the sharing that you've done today and all that you do, both of you. We are very grateful for you, and I'm so glad we had you join us today for the conference. I want to thank everyone in attendance for being part of this event and for your commitment and efforts to confront racial injustice. And I want to let you know that I've put in the chat the link to the closing panel discussion and that we hope you will join us there. That is starting in just a moment. And lastly, I'll just mention that you can watch for an email with a link to complete an evaluation of today's presentation and a separate email about CEUs for those of you that requested CEUs when you registered. So with that, again, a huge, huge, huge thank you to our panelists and thank you all for joining us.
Thank you, Tova.
Thank you, everyone.
And thank you, everyone.